I'm Aditi, and he's Ramesh. And we are here to talk about scaling our real-time streaming warehouse with Flink, Parquet, and Kubernetes. So we are both working on the data platform at Branch, where we are basically working on the infrastructure that powers the analytics with the streaming and the batch pipelines. I'm Ramesh. So for this talk, we would first cover the background and our choice of Flink as the streaming infrastructure. Then we'll talk about moving data with Flink at Branch and the scale and performance challenges. Then we'll cover the deployment of Flink on Kubernetes along with auto-scaling and failure recovery. So Branch helps companies provide seamless mobile experiences through our linking infrastructure. And for this, we process 20 billion requests per day and more than 100 terabytes of data every day. We also have, for the streaming infrastructure, more than 300,000 events processed per second, which run on more than 100 Flink pipelines on Kubernetes. So as you can see, we use a lot of open source tools, and Flink is one of the important core components for the streaming infrastructure, along with Druid for the OLAP data store, Kubernetes for the job orchestration, and Airflow, Presto, and Spark. So why do we need streaming as a platform at Branch? So in general, whether at life at work, we are continuously receiving information, processing it, and responding to it. Not only do we have to do it really fast, but also we have to do it very well. And how well we respond to information determines success or failure. At Branch, we use Flink and Druid to power the real-time analytics, which provide filter app event data on campaigns, advertisers, and many other dimensions. So we have been running Flink at Branch for 2 years in production. And we chose Flink as the platform because it treats streaming as the first-class citizen, processing one event at a time. So it's unlike micro-batching systems, which have latency and throughput trade-offs based on the batch size. This diagram gives an overview of our event ingestion pipeline. So we use Flink for ingesting the raw protobuf messages in Kafka. And then we have schema flattening and filtering and other transformations to produce Parquet files in the HDFS warehouse. And for the messages in protobuf format in the Kafka topics, we have more than 150 dimensions. Many of them have high cardinality and nested structures. Then we use the bucketing sink to write the Parquet files into HDFS. And it's integrated with the checkpointing mechanism to ensure exactly one's delivery semantics. We also have our custom Parquet writer and the bucketing sink, which writes the Parquet files within hourly buckets in HDFS. We have a relatively small state backend, so we go with the file system based. So for our use case, RocksDB was an overkill because of the small state size, and also because the working state for RocksDB is on the disk, so we had performance bottlenecks around that. So Parquet is the format that we use for writing the files into our warehouse. The reason we chose Parquet is because it is a compressed columnar storage. And for most of our use case, we query a subset of the fields from the data. So it's really useful in terms of performance and added features like predicate pushdown and column pruning. Also, we use Avro as the serialization format because it provides type safety and is very useful for schema evolution and migration. So the Parquet format is really great, but the problem is that with Flink, it's very memory intensive to write. So we had to tune our pipelines to make sure that the task manager have memory properly managed with the Flink pipelines while writing Parquet, as well as do some changes on the Parquet writer to use incremental buffering. So these are the approaches that we used for writing Parquet files with Flink. The first was closing every file on a checkpoint and starting a new file. But the problem with this approach was that there were too many small files generated, and more so when there are delayed events coming in the stream or when the checkpoint interval is very small. So the second approach tried was to use the bucketing sink, which allocates a message to a file based on the timestamp. And this is configured with a custom event time bucketer, a Parquet writer, and the batch size, which matches the Parquet block size. Also, within each bucket, the files are rolled out based on their size and a timeout of 10 minutes of inactivity. So in this approach, the problem was not actually the scale, but rather recovery, because the bucketing sync truncates the file during the recovery to the last successful checkpoint. But since we are using Parquet, which is columnar format written in blocks, a block cannot be truncated and started from an arbitrary point. So the fix for this was to checkpoint and close every block at the same time. Let's move on to the performance and scale. So we have been witnessing 100% traffic increase every year, and this we had to make sure that we are able to support the increasing scale at the same time the systems and the pipelines are stable. So we tune the max parallelism to a high enough value to suit our needs in scalability, but keeping it lower actually had better performance. Also, for the cases when the Kafka topic had lesser partitions than the Flink parallelism, there were few Flink instances which would not receive any messages. So there's a rebalance that has to be done on the input stream, which further causes repartitioning. Another challenge with high parallelism was task manager timeouts. When there are too many task managers, there are job restarts, and it causes performance degradation. Let's take a look at the memory management. So Flink uses memory mainly for storing and processing data objects. And the challenge with memory management is more prominent when the traffic is very high or when there are lots of delayed events in the stream. The two main factors that affected our memory usage in most of our applications was the message size and the records per second. So the Parquet format is great for only the messages which have lesser fields. Like when there are too many fields in the message, the Parquet writer has to pre-allocate some space to compress and buffer that column, which further adds to the memory overhead. And also in the reader side, it leads to degraded performance. The other factors that affected the memory usage were the throughput or the records per second, then the checkpoint frequency and the state backend access pattern based on whether it's storing the state on the disk or memory. Then the row group size and the Parquet page size affecting the reader performance and the network buffers. So the task manager heap is consumed by the network buffers, by the memory segments which store the serialized data and the user code which is storing the data structures and the structures that are used within the code, in the application code. So we collected the memory and the garbage collection stats with debug parameters and then analyzed them with tools like Visual VM or JHAT. And that helped us to figure out which particular classes in Parquet MR were consuming the most memory. And then there was a fix to change the buffering in Parquet Writer to incremental from a bulk buffering. So we ran all these clusters initially on Mesos as the orchestrator, and each Flink application was run as a framework. But the challenge with Mesos was ensuring resource guarantees. So the startup time was really high for the streaming jobs whenever there's a restart or there's a scale up or down. So also along with that, the operational overhead of Mesos is higher compared to Kubernetes. So Kubernetes is more resource oriented and declarative, and it's easier to manage your streaming application with the restarts and the scale ups. So we leveraged the save point mechanism in Flink to migrate our streaming jobs to Kubernetes, where we use a user initiated save point to start a parallel instance, which would have lesser startup time and was easier to manage and configure. So now Ramesh will go into the details of deploying and scaling our Flink pipelines on Kubernetes.
Thank you, Aditi. Today I'm going to talk about three things: how we run our pipelines in Kubernetes and auto-scaling, finally failure recovery. I quickly touch the basic things about the Kubernetes. The pod is the lowest deployment unit. One or more container group together and deployed as a pod. Node, as you know, it's a virtual machine or bare metal. In AWS, each EC2 instance as a node. The replica set, it scales the pod horizontally. So if you say five replica, it will create five pods there. And then finally, higher level API is deployment. It manages the replica set and version control. If you want to roll back the version, you can use the deployment to roll back. Yeah. So this is a view of our Flink cluster. We run only one job per cluster. The reason for that, we can easily define resources per job, and then we can easily deploy and operate. So now Flink has two components, task manager and job manager. Those are defined as Kubernetes deployment here. The communication between the task manager and job manager is a little challenging here because whenever the job manager restarts, it will get new IP address. So the Kubernetes service provide local DNS and virtual IP to the pod. So the task manager use service to communicate the job manager. So if you look into the detail, the job manager pod, there are two containers running. One is job manager, that's a Flink job manager. And another one is our custom container, it's called job launcher. So the application jar packaged into the job launcher. Once the cluster started, the job launcher will upload the jar to the job manager. So we added a lot of features into the job launcher. We'll see it later. Yeah, auto-scaling. Scaling is a three-stage process. First, we need to know when to scale and how much to scale. So we have all the metrics are stored in Prometheus. So the job launcher will read those metrics and see whether pipeline is lagging or not. If it lags continuously, then it will decide to scale the cluster. So we have predefined scaling factor per job. Based on that, it will determine the new cluster size, and then it will update to the deployment controller. It will update new replica set. In second stage is actual scaling. When the Kubernetes controller sees the new replica set value, it will launch the new task manager pods. In case if there are no node available at the time, we have the autoscaler, Kubernetes autoscaler, that's connected to the AWS scaling group. The AST will add new nodes to the cluster, and then the controller will add task manager after that. So we got cluster scaled up, but the job running on the cluster is still using the old parallelism. So the last stage, the job launcher will resubmit the job with new parallelism. So that's how we scale. We won't scale it manually, so we can use the Kubernetes scale command, just change the replica, rest of the thing will be automatically added. Failure recovery. These are some common problems in production. So we created a self-healing solution for that. I will go through some of them. Yeah, the pod in Kubernetes can restart any number of time. There could be different reasons for that. So the task manager or job manager, they may go down. When it happens, the controller will relaunch the job manager and task manager pod automatically. And then our custom job launcher will resubmit the job to the cluster. And then job will restart from the save point. We heavily use the Flink save point. So the Kubernetes and our custom job launcher and Flink save point will work together to self-heal this issue. Yeah. Another thing, we always expect the job will restart from the save point. There could be some reason it may fail. In our cases, we use the bucketing thing. It has the concept of when recovered from the save point, it truncates the file, Parquet file. Sometimes that fails. And during the application migration, there could be some breaking change in the schema. Or we use the HDFS to write checkpoint. So downtime of the HDFS might cause the save point failure. So the way we store the checkpoint, all the checkpoints are stored for the job under the folder called runid. Runid is just incremental number. So whenever the job not able to start from the save point, we'll increment the runid. In here, it's ingestion job. It reads from the Kafka currently writing to the hour 12. If failure happens, save point failure, what we will do? We ignore the, all the checkpoints, previous checkpoint, because the job is not starting from the save point, so no use of that one. We create new save point, new run ID. That's a new route for the save point. So all the future save point will be written here. And then second step, in the sync side, all the in-progress file will delete it. And then we start the job from the head of the Kafka, the earliest offset. The job will scan through all the partition, only start writing after last completion bucket. Yeah, it's a resource intensive process, but it's a rare instant that save point failure happen. Whenever happen, we don't need to manually do anything. And the pipeline will self heal itself. And also we do auto scale if during this time, and then scale down later. Okay. So there could be some other reason your job may go down. So in our platform, we have Flink as a platform. So whenever you add new job to the platform, that alerts and then monitoring, everything will be added automatically. When job goes down, we'll get the pager. The first thing we will do, we start the job from the latest offset. So that streaming will continue. And then we have backfill cluster that will catch up the data. Finally, using Parquet in streaming, it takes a lot of memory. And especially when there are multiple files are open, if the upstream is lagging, we have to write a lot of files, then it takes a lot of memory. We have to scale that time. So to avoid that, we tried a couple of approaches. The first one is using the RocksDB. So buffering into that, bucketing data into the RocksDB, once the window expires, we'll write into that HDFS. It works. Again, problem with that, we need to manage two memory model, RocksDB and Flink. So we had one issue, controlling RocksDB memory in container environment, we had issues. Sometimes what happened, it takes memory more than pod limit, that Kubernetes killed that pod. So we tried 5 to 6 profile for RocksDB and then different profile for our JVM. So yeah, finally we ended up adding more complexity to the ingestion pipeline. So that's why we didn't go that route. The second approach is using the two staging process. Flink works very well with row-oriented format. So writing data in Avro and then later batch will come convert into Avro to Parquet. Again, downside of this approach, latency. So it will take some time to batch. Latency will take, after the bucket complete, the batch will come and then create the Parquet. So there's a latency in there. Yeah, the community is also working to improve that bulk writing in Flink. Yeah, that's all. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. The first one is about auto-scaling Kubernetes. Mm-hmm. If you're letting from what I understood, the parallelism is decided dynamically.
Yeah.
So my question is, if the parallelism factor modulo the number of partitions of the input stream is not equal to zero, you're going to get some skew of records on the task slots. So how do you handle the modulo math surrounding that? That's the first question. The second question is concerning some of the scalability questions you had, like in terms of Parquet writing. I'm wondering what the trade-offs were in considering the data architecture of a star schema versus a wide warehouse table.
Okay, the first question. So how do you handle modularism, in case of some bucket partition will have different amount of data? We didn't put more logic on the auto-scaling. Everything is linear scaling. So we didn't calculate message record per size or everything. It's just linear scaling. If it continuously lags, we will increase it. Again, if it continuously lags, we increase it. The There are few pipelines, we had the issue. So only for those few pipelines, we have the rebalancing. When we read from the Kafka, we add one more step, first rebalance it, and then we do all our operation. So Parquet question?
Yeah, so most of our use cases that use Parquet, they are like Presto and Druid ingestion, which cannot use the star schema because it would have too many dimension tables. So we needed bulk large tables, which had most of the fields, and then query them on those. So, yeah.
Thank you. Any question?
Aditi, in your slides, you mentioned about the problems you had with partitions with Kafka, changing them and not being able to rebalance. How did you solve that problem?
So this was actually like whenever the Kafka topic had lesser partitions, or it actually had more partitions than the parallelism, then we had to rebalance, and that added to the throughput. Like we would have more repartitioning. So the fix was to rebalance, but it had performance trade-offs there.
Yeah. So when you say rebalance, what do you mean exactly? On the Kafka side?
No, on the Flink side. So there's a rebalance function, which would basically rebalance the data to all the instances of Flink.
And also some cases, we go back to that Kafka and repartition with new partition size. It's manual effort, we have to do it.
Yeah, that's what I was asking about, yeah. In terms of the repartitioning on Kafka side.
So for that, one way would be like you could publish it to another topic and then use it with more partitions. But we usually do it like manually. We change the scale, this parallelism according to the partitions.
Yeah, but when you repartition, won't you lose the ordering guarantees and all those things because now they belong to different partitions?
Yeah, right. So the partition order is guaranteed within a partition, but not across. So for the bucketing sync, we use the timestamp. It's a field in the message to allocate the hourly bucket. So even if it's like mixed into different partitions, we still have it processed by the event time.
Thank